But to open the session, I'm very pleased that Christian Basen, the director of the Danish Design Center in Copenhagen, will lead us into his view of policy innovation. I believe there's no other person in Europe, maybe on the planet, who has more experience in policy innovation than Christian Basen. From 2007 to 2014, he was the director of MindLab, and we just learned in the morning that the Singapore innovation was also driven by the MindLab, by a visit of Agnes Quek, who was leading that innovation process at that time, and visiting the MindLab. And that was the innovation team at the Danish government at that time. And he's the author of 7 books, the latest from 2017, Leading Public Design. And 11 years ago, he published Leading Public Sector Innovation, which became somehow a standard work in the policy innovation field. Since 2000, I think you are working on a new one, but you'll probably talk about that. And since 2014, Christian Basen is the CEO of the Danish Design Center in Copenhagen, which is a design thinking center par excellence. At least from my impression, when I was visiting you, I got the feeling, yes, this is a very good design thinking place. And I'm very happy that he's opening the Insights from Europe session today. Please welcome Christian Basen, Design Thinking for a Systemic Change. Your stage is yours.
Thank you so much for your very, very kind introduction. Really a pleasure to be with everyone today and provide some European perspectives. And I suppose my role is to provide the Northern European or Scandinavian one. I'll share my screen and have a few slides for you for about a 15-minute presentation. So design thinking for systemic change. What is the challenge there? And I'll go a little bit shifting between my past experience from leading MindLab from within side the Danish government and to the experience today working very, very closely with the government, however, as an independent foundation. So this image is from a conference center near Copenhagen. If you look very closely, you can see the logo on the name tags from when Denmark had the European Union presidency. So the folks in the picture, and interesting enough, mostly men, are ministers, policymakers, political figures, all of them ministers of commerce, business and finance that are holding their European Council meeting. And for this meeting, when I was leading MindLab, we had the pleasure of creating the entire service design process for them. I won't go into detail because we basically curated 24 hours of immersive experience in Copenhagen and working digitally. This is images from 2012, and you see them all with tablets, which was not very usual back then. And these tablets were actually not their own. We provided them. But what it shows is what it is like when you use design thinking to invite policymakers at very powerful level across all of Europe to engage in a different conversation. So what we did was we created videos of how citizens experience European regulation and challenges in their everyday lives, challenges that these ministers could do something about. We created films with companies and about their challenges with red tape and bureaucracy and regulation. And then we basically use that as fuel, as empathy fuel, to power a conversation and a dialogue between ministers in a very informal way, which meant that all the normal bureaucrats and civil servants who would flank and be close to ministers were not there. And basically introducing, and I'll get back to what I mean by that, design thinking principles into the power situation. So here's an example from one of the films. The user-centeredness of bringing a consumer, a citizen, a person from Europe into play and sharing his story about dealing with European regulation. This was in the space of trade and commerce, and how this young man had tried to buy a pair of very expensive shoes for his wife in another country in Europe, and they never arrived, and he lost his money. And the policy problem here was, how do we create European regulation so that in the future, Morten here could get his money back when his the box for his wife didn't arrive. Of course, as you said in the video, big problem, which is this when you can't get the present that you had purchased. So an example of how power and people can connect. And in many ways, I think that's even not too strong a word to say that's one of the big democratic challenges of our time is, how can we connect people and power, and how can we give people power so that when we make policy, when we make decisions, it actually transforms their lives. And transformation is something that we truly, really, really need today, because we have a pressing climate change and crisis there. And we have young people leading the way in demonstrations and actions and movements to put pressure on policy that way around. We have a digital transformation that is changing our lives in many ways for the better. It enables us to connect globally today, but it also has a risk of making people lonely. We have a surge in mental health problems, not least for young people. We have screen and tablet and mobile phone addiction. With loneliness, and we need to find a way to create digital solutions that are ethical, that take care of our privacy, that are transparent, especially when we begin to look into artificial intelligence and the role of design and designers in making digital solutions that are good for people and for the planet. And we have rapid societal change, we have rapid urbanization, and we have challenges in questioning how do we need to live together, how can the built environment become much more sustainable, how can we again create coherence and connectivity in our societies to enable good lives. And then when preparing for this session, we had a good conversation, Ulia and I and colleagues, and of course there's also this, that we also in a world with conflict, with some very fundamental changes also in the global power distribution. And you can ask, what's the level of thinking and doing that can help us prevent terrible outcomes as the ones we've seen mainly for the people in this case of Afghanistan, but also for people around the world that are where we are not solving problems, but we actually perhaps creating new ones as we attempt to solve the current ones. So we've been Denmark Design Lab for the last more than 40 years, since 1978, and I'm very pleased to be able to share some of our experience also from the Danish Design Center with you today. We say we unleash people's ability to create a sustainable world, and by that we mean that everybody, of course, has the ability to take part in design processes, to be a designer. Some are professionally trained, others it can tap into the world of design thinking as an approachable set of methodologies and tools. But first and foremost, I think that we all know that design is more than just tools and processes. It's all about how you think about solving problems and how you think about creating new opportunities and having that mindset around the future and around creating something better than we have today. This is our home in Copenhagen, and we already heard about some of the books, so that you can dive into some of them if you want to know more about designing for policy and for public sector and innovation. One of the things I was also involved in a while ago, actually also in 2012, was this work on how can we power public sector innovation across Europe through design, and with a vision that we articulated in this expert group I was chairing. Once we need a pervasive change of mindset, as I said before, with more experimentation, take more risk, be agile, and also personalized and citizen-centered in the way we deal with challenges. And so there's actually a document that shows how the European Union has that ambition. And actually since then, I and colleagues have been training directors and teams and managers in the European institutions to bring innovation and design thinking into the core of Europe. This was Mind Lab. This is what it looked like, not all the time because the flowers were put there for the photo session. But the idea of putting a lab or space, a physical space inside a government building as partly a provocation, but I think mainly a resource and an opportunity, I think is still powerful. And it's something that many organizations, as you heard about this morning, around the world are still venturing to do, to create space and place for innovation to flourish, often powered by design. There was a big journey at MindLab. This is one of my colleagues that visualized the journey until about 2015, also just around the time when I left. But what I want to summarize, because you can't read the whole thing, it's you can let me know if you want it, and of course you can have the slides from today that they're for you to take. But the learnings from the exercise of embedding design into government was basically that it is possible to bring the citizen perspective, just like we did with the ministers, into shaping public policy when you have a concerted effort and when you have a connectivity to also the top management in the ministry. Government needs these kind of platforms to enable cross-ministerial and multi-level collaboration. And interestingly enough, after MindLab was closed 3 years ago, new initiatives have sprung up to try to connect people across. And there's a network now of civil servants working with design thinking in the Danish government. And we here at the center also work on cross-cutting networks, for example, on social innovation. Leadership is essential, and I'll get back to that, but it's a really, really important piece to embrace new ways of innovating, to tap into the role of managers and the role of leadership. So we all, I think most of us will recognize that design thinking is about exploring problem spaces, getting close to users, co-creating new solutions, and prototyping, testing, iterating to make the future concrete. And that also goes for designing within government settings. So we would, at the Danish Design Center, still using these methods with working with government, dive into how citizens and, in this case, enterprises experience interacting with government, go out and visit farms to explore the problem in practice and understand what it takes to make it easier and more smooth to run a farming company, to co-create with citizens and other stakeholders in collaborative ways. All of which I think leads to the question of what more is needed. And again, I'll address this, as Uli said, in an upcoming book. I won't say too much about it today. That'll be next time, maybe next year. But I think we need to move towards more systemic design. And by that, I mean that we need to shift away from thinking we can just and only use design thinking to solve concrete, quite limited challenges that arise in the interaction between citizens and the public sector. So you could say a narrow view of service design. I'm not saying it's not important and can make a difference, but I'm saying that this design focus on user experience and behavior at a very discrete level is not going to be enough to solve and address and make the transitions we need across green and digital and social, as I said before, to deal with the big problems of our time, the big policy problems of our time. So to address more complex and turbulent and wicked emerging problems, we need to go to a more systemic level. And systemic, of course, means working with all the interactive parts and actors across a field, across a problem field, and where the design focus is the very system that produces or co-produces value, or the opposite of value, produces problems for citizens and society. So it means designing with the system at the center, without losing empathy, without losing the human aspect, of course. But I think that's where we need to head. And that's what I would have loved to keep doing if I stayed at MindLab, but that's also what we do here at the Danish Design Center, where we as an independent platform work on mission-led and mission-oriented innovation to take a systemic approach to these big transitions. For example, on circular economy, here's an example, you can't read all the details, but how we are mapping out a hypothesis set around what does it take to drive a more circular economy and circular change across all of Denmark, mapping out value creating systems, mapping out the actors, and then of course, always deep diving back into what's it like to run a small company that needs to make this transition to a circular business model and circular products and services. I'm going to conclude by asking how to enable systems transformation. I have some very short bets for you before ending. First of all, back to power and people. We need human-centered leadership. And speaking of people, we need human-centered organizations. Those are perhaps in some ways the missing parts when we talk about the role and the power of design thinking. Because design thinking is challenging because it involves more than just managing change. It involves discovering what kind of change is needed, which means it means that leaders must take responsibility for this kind of discovery process. And I've written with a colleague about that in Harvard Business Review. You can check out the article here. It's called The Right Way to Lead Design Thinking, but where we basically argue that we need to leverage empathy as leaders. We need to insist on bringing more stakeholders in across a system. And then we need, of course, to insist on creating intangible futures and rehearsing the future through the iterative process of experimentation and test and trial and error. Finally, on the other piece on people-centered organizations, we need to create organizations that are built around people, not around hierarchy or bureaucracy, which means, like we do, choose your own leader, be able to offer leadership to others, even if you're a young employee. Smooth, agile, open-ended organizations with no fixed teams or departments, and the ability to freely choose where you want to work. We believe in a way to view humans and you view people, which I think resonates very much with design, that people work best when they're trusted, when they are enabled to create positive change, when they can make independent decisions on their own, because people are powerful and able if they're given the right conditions. And they will take responsibility and will share and will help others. And people will want to follow leaders as well as wanting to lead. So this is, to conclude, the drivers of systemic change, not just systemic design or design thinking, but also design leadership and also TEAL organization or human-centered organizations. Because to transform systems, which we need to do to really get the world back on track and create a better future, we need to understand that we have to go through zones of uncertainty, and that is the amazing power of design, is to help us navigate through ambiguity and uncertainty and still create a better future. Thank you for listening.